Before we get started, give the listeners just a little bit of your background on where you came from and what you do.
Yeah, so I started life actually as a computer programmer, but I got bored and I went to veterinary school thinking that I was going to help people fix dogs with behavior problems. And then come to find out I wasn't all that interested in fixing broken dogs. I was a lot more interested in figuring out what breaks them in the first place and understanding their brains. And while I was there, I did a master's degree studying stress in dogs who are healthy dogs who are hospitalized. So they were dogs who were coming in for like spay neuter surgery or orthopedic surgery. So they were pretty healthy, but they were overnight in the hospital the first night before their surgery. And so I studied what their stress levels looked like there. And so I got really interested in stress in dogs, but it was hard to figure out how to do that research because people really just that kind of stuff. People really want you to cut open the head and take the brain out, which we don't like to do on dogs. And then it's, you know, it's hard to then go look at the same dog's response later on once you've taken their brain out. So, but that was a time that genetics was really booming. And I discovered that you can learn a lot about at least the genetic predisposition to certain personality traits through genetics. And so that's what I'm doing right now. I'm working at Carlson Laboratory at the Broad Institute in Cambridge, Massachusetts, which is a big human genomics institute. And we are the little lab that studies non-human animals and mostly dogs, but a lot of other stuff too, sort of on the side. And oh God, I shouldn't say on the side because my coworkers will listen to this and get mad. But from my perspective, the dogs are the most important part. And so we study pet dogs who are in the home. So people answer a whole bunch of behavioral surveys about their dogs. So we understand a lot of stuff about the dog's personality. And then we can also look at the dog's DNA through saliva swabs. So that is the non-invasive way that I study dog genetics of personality now.
That, I think that's I think you answered that very well. And there, and that's a common question people have, because when we talk about, you know, social anxiety or anxiety at home, or, you know, you mentioned bringing a dog into the vet, obviously that's a new situation and could be associated with a negative and cause some anxiety. It's like, how the hell do you measure that in a dog? And I was wondering if you did it through, you know, cortisol levels or something like that, but you're actually... Is that something you do too, or is it?
Yeah. So the master's degree that I was talking about, we were measuring cortisol levels. And the thing about cortisol, I actually wrote a blog post. That was when I first started blogging when I was in veterinary school. And I wrote a blog post titled something like "Why Cortisol Sucks for Measuring Stress." And it's the best hormonal measurement that we have, but that doesn't make it a good measurement. So there's just a zillion reasons, which I'm more than happy to geek out with you about, but there's a zillion reasons why it's not all that reliable. It's only the best that we have. So the best recommendation that we have for studying stress is to use at least two different measurements. And so I was studying both cortisol and behavior. And so the idea was to try to figure out if the dog shows these behaviors, then does that mean the cortisol levels? Can we use those two things together to try to figure out if the dog is stressed in the hospital or not? Sorry, you were asking what I do. So what I do today, right now, we're only looking at genetics. I am super interested in that whole stress response. And it's a very complex response. There's a lot of different parts of the brain and other parts of the body that are involved in it. And so my goal, once we get the money, this is going to be a common theme for me, is once we get the money to do this research, is to look, once again, going at the actual brains and looking at how the brain functions differently. And we can do this looking at gene expression, which again, I'm happy to explain, but it's a little bit different than looking at the DNA. So I would look at that in the actual brain regions that are associated with the stress response. And because we don't like to swoop into people's homes, steal their dogs, and take their dog's brains out, what we're working on is setting up a system where if someone is euthanizing their dog for another reason, then we would take that body donation, just like humans donate cadavers. Mm-hmm. So that's my hope longer term, is to be able to look at more directly at functionality that way. But all I'm able to do right now is to look at things like, you know, what your genetic risk for becoming an anxious or aggressive dog is.
So there's a lot to unpack there. When you talk about, you know, somebody takes their dog in and they have to euthanize their dog for whatever reason, and you could get that brain, you're looking for something in there, because you can take the genetic, you can take, you know, break down the genes, and you can look at certain things in their brain like that and compare those two, or how does that work? What are you doing with the brains?
Sure. So the ideal study that I would like And again, this is very hard to set up, so this is in the future, would be is if I had two sets of owners, one, both of whom had filled out all of our behavioral surveys, so we knew a lot about the dogs' personalities. And I'd like one set of people who had really resilient dogs that you could try to stress the dog out and the dog bounced right back. The dog did really well. And then the other set, I would like maybe very aggressive dogs or very shy dogs. And so then I would like to be able to compare these two groups, right? I mean, that's how scientific studies work, is you have a group that looks one way, a group that looks another way. So compare those two groups. So then what I would do is I would look at particular brain regions. So one, the one that I'm fascinated with right now, and a lot of stress, human stress researchers are really fascinated with, is called the hippocampus. And the hippocampus has to do with learning and memory, is how people really like to summarize it. But it's also deeply involved in the stress response. And it's very much involved in what I like to call the off switch of the stress response. So if you think about one thing that a really stress resilient dog will show is that when something happens to stress him out, he recovers very quickly. Right. And I saw this in my shy dog when I first adopted her. Something would stress her out and it would be hours before her behavior came back to normal. And now it's minutes, now that she's doing a lot better. And that is a functionality that's in the hippocampus. We understand it pretty well. Again, I'm happy to go into more details, but I don't want to dive. We can just keep diving deep and deeper. So I'm just going to stop diving there. So then I would take hippocampuses from both the resilient dogs and the not resilient dogs, and I would compare their functionality. So there's a bunch of different ways that we can do that. And again, that would be a deep dive to explain them, and it's totally up to you what you want to dive into. Epigenetics is one thing, so that sort of code on top of the DNA. Another thing is that in the hippocampus, so basically the way genetics works, fast genetics class for you. Genes are there to make protein. So a gene is code for a protein. And there's a particular protein that is very functional in that off switch. And animals that have a faster off switch have more of these proteins. And so one thing that I could do is just count either how many of the proteins there are, or at a previous level, how many of the instructions for making those proteins the hippocampus is making. Is that making sense?
Yep.
Yeah. So I could look at that. So that would be a functional difference, which means that it either could be due to the animal's genetics or it could be due to their environment. So you said their socialization, which is why we want to look at the actual brains, because then we can see these functional differences due to either genetics or to environment.
So you're digging in and you're looking at the level of genetic predisposition to this, you know, to stress and anxiety, and that's tied into the recovery, the off switch. But you can't divorce, and maybe correct me if I'm wrong here, but you can't really divorce the genetics from the environment. I mean, they're both playing in there, and you're just looking at this going, okay, we can dig into the hippocampus and see with this dog, knowing its personality history and everything, like you can make some correlations there and you go, all right, we know a dog with this genetic predisposition is probably going to be, you know, this level of stressed or have this trouble recovering from stress. Is that right?
Right. So yes. And so all of this is sort of future, right? So there's two branches to this ideal future study. And the current branch is what we're working on right now, is being able to predict that genetic predisposition to stress. So right now, and the two things will interact together beautifully. So right now, what we're doing is we're getting people's descriptions of their dog's behavior. And as you know, that behavior has something to do with genetics and something to do with environment, and we can't really pick it apart. Then we're looking at the dog's genetics. And we're doing these studies where we look at the genetics, we look at the behavior, and we try to find associations. So that the idea is that once we have enough dogs, and I'll come back to my theme of money here, but we're at around 2,000 dogs right now, so we're getting there. And so the idea is that as we keep doing this work, we'll start finding genes that, oh, if this gene looks like this, it means that this dog probably has a higher risk of being a stressy dog, right? And it's going to end up being that there are dozens of genes that interact to do that. Mm-hmm. So it's a very complex task, but that's what we're working on right now. If I can get this other arm started where we're also looking at the brain, then you're coming at it sort of from the other side and you're saying, well, again, I don't know whether this was genetics or whether this was environment, but I can see the brain is acting this way. So if I had all three of these things for dogs, if I had the description of their personality, if I had this functional stuff in the brain, and if I had information about their DNA in the context of what it means with a lot of other dogs' personalities, a lot of other dogs' DNA, then I can start to triangulate it. So it's a very, very big, complicated question that we have to come at from a lot of different angles to try to get at it. And it's early days yet.
So if we hop into a time machine and we get you 10 years down the road and a ton of money for research, is the goal of this not only just to truly understand, but to also be able to breed for dogs that have a better off switch and handle stress better? Is that a possibility?
You just hit the nail exactly on the head. That's okay. Great. A lot of people see, this is how it's different, the different groups that I talk to. A lot of people say to me, well, will you be able to test for a dog? So a lot of people want a genetic test for aggression. That's always going to be challenging, right? Like if I do a genetic test on a shelter dog who I don't know and I test for aggression, well, maybe he has an increased risk of developing it. But at this point, he's an adult. Maybe he had a lovely childhood and he never is going to develop aggression. All I can tell you is the risk. But risk is very useful when you're breeding dogs. So that is exactly the right way to go. So yeah, I'm really, really getting excited these days about thinking about how we can use this information to start pushing populations of dogs that we breed in certain directions. And by the way, I listened to the podcast that you did with Sarah Bruski because I wanted to know what I was following up on. And I noticed from that you really like Labrador Retrievers, unsurprisingly. And Labs are super weird dogs in the dog world. We all think of them as normal because we sort of think of them as like, a lot of people think of Labs as like the ultimate dog. They're great family dogs. They're very friendly. They like to do all the things that we think of dogs liking to do, like play fetch and swim. And when you look at all the other breeds, that's not actually all that normal for a dog to be so unafraid of novel things, so friendly to all humans and all dogs, many of them, so interested in toys, so interested in food. The food stuff, by the way, with Labs, there's an interesting study, which we may talk about later in this podcast if you want, that another lab, not ours, actually did find a lot of the genetic reasons why Labs are so interested in food. But so in terms of personality, though, Labs are pretty unusual and they're great for me because there's so many of them out there. But I really like the idea of starting to breed Lab into more of the dogs that we use for other things. I mean, it's no surprise that Labs are a mainstay of working dogs when it comes particularly to like guide dogs and assistance dogs, because they can be just rock solid. And so when you talk about resilience, they are the ultimate in resilience. I was at one guide dog school where they were testing their dogs. So they had bred these dogs. They'd had them in foster homes for their first year. Now they're bringing in these like 13-month-old dogs to test and see, are we going to actually take these in and commit all the resources to training them to be guide dogs? And they were testing them. One of the many things they did was they would open an umbrella in the dog's face. And I watched this one dog is running up to the person to say hi, and they opened the umbrella in the dog's face, which would have just killed either of my herding dogs, right? They would have completely come unglued. This dog does not even pause, right? He just blunders right on into the umbrella. And I turned to the guy who worked at the school who was standing next to me, and I was like, that's pretty amazing. And he said, yeah, we may have bred some self-preservation out of them. I just love, like, you can go a little too far. You can see he was sort of like, that was not really the result he had wanted to see with that dog. But they're pretty amazing. And so the world that I come from these days in working with dogs is very much the dog sports world. So I got one of my current dogs to do agility with. He has some orthopedic problems, so we're now doing nose work and rally, stuff like that. And I see all of these dogs bred to be very responsive to the handler and very smart and very high energy, but people aren't focusing as much on breeding them for being resilient in the trial environment. And we expect these highly sensitive dogs to come into an environment So, I mean, you guys with your field trials are probably a bit more open and outside and a bit more different, but an agility trial is often inside, particularly in the winter, obviously. There's a lot of dogs, a lot of barking, a lot of people, not a lot of space to move around, dogs in your face. Maybe you're going to be crated for a lot of the day and dogs are going to be coming right by your crate staring at you. It is a challenging environment for a sensitive herding dog. I want to breed some lab in. Like, I don't think they need to be all lab or even half lab. But, I, you know, like 10, 20%, I feel like if we breed some lab in and then select for that resilience, it could be quite an amazing sporting dog. So that's one of the things I'm harping on these days is the joy of the Labrador Retriever.
There's a lot of reasons we talk about labs. I'm sure there are people listening to this going, this lady is bananas if she thinks we should be breeding collies to labs. That's a different topic. But yeah. The reason, you know, I love labs. They fit into my life. I've had Goldens, and I've never thought of it in the way that you just put it, where, you know, breeding out some of the self-preservation, some of the fear. And I always think, you know, when you talk about you take a Labrador Retriever, a well-bred Labrador Retriever in a field trial or out hunting or whatever, what you want is that drive. You know, in addition to the, you know, athleticism and the health, you want drive. And I always think about that, like, okay, we're breeding for drive. We want dogs with rocket fuel in their blood that can go and go and go, and that's all they want to do. I've never thought about there being a component there where it's like we've taken away their self-preservation to some extent, so they don't fear that. Like, I always, when I watch my dog, you know, we talk about this a lot, where I hunt pheasants and cattail sloughs, and the cattail sloughs are as tall as me. They're 6 feet tall, and my dog just goes boosh, right through them without even thinking, like, what's on the other side. My Golden Retriever would not do that. My Golden Retriever, she would approach everything like, I'm going to, you know, like, put my toe in the water here. I'm not going to just go, you know, crazy for it. And I've never thought about it from that perspective. And that's fascinating. And it almost has to be the self-preservation being tamped down in those dogs almost has to be just a side effect, at least partially, of their popularity. They're the most popular sporting dog in this country. And people have leaned into labs so hard for so many different things that it just, I don't know, like, maybe it's a chicken or the egg thing, but it has become that now with those dogs. And I never thought about it that way.
Not just the most popular sporting dog, but I believe they are the most popular breed currently. Although a lot of the pet ones that come from show lines, which, as I'm sure you know, are quite different behaviorally and physically.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons I wanted to talk to you, because one of the things I've always pushed with this podcast, and one of the reasons we wanted to start it, is to get people to think about their puppy choice beyond aesthetics and think about what kind of breeding are you buying from? What kind of bloodlines? What kind of life are you going to offer the kind of dog you want? Because it goes both ways. You know, we think like, oh, I want this kind of dog in my life because I like how they look, or I had one as a kid. And it's like, okay, well, do you work 80 hours a week and have no time to get that dog out? Or are you retired and have tons of, like, so that was why I was interested in having you on, partially because that, I don't think you can overstate how important it is to really be honest about what kind of dog you want and what kind of breeding you're condoning by buying a dog.
Yes, that is so important. And so I would say it's both the genetics. And so you should think about how it was bred very, very carefully, 100%. And then it's also socialization. And it turns out, you know, we think of socialization as being something that we do when we bring this 8-week puppy home. And the socialization window closes around 16 weeks. So you've got that 2 months, right, to do it. And that is a super, super important time that you should put a lot of effort into. But in fact, socialization is starting when the puppy leaves the nest, right? And it's brain. And again, we can do a deep dive on this if you want to, but it's brain. There's some very specific ways that its brain actually functions differently that end around between 5 to 7 weeks, depending on the breed, which is, by the way, another way in which Labrador Retrievers are unusual, is that that those early brain differences close later, more around 7 weeks as compared to other puppies. But that first sort of 1 to 3 weeks that they're out of the nest moving around while they're at the breeders are super important. You get much more bang for your buck socializing during those weeks than you do weeks 8 to 16, which means that it's not just genetics. It's also how good the breeder is at socializing the puppies. And so if you go to someone who's sort of a more of a traditional puppy raiser and has them, you know, out in a barn and isn't doing a whole lot with them, and you're thinking, well, I'm going to bring this puppy home and socialize it to be a great pet in addition to being my hunting companion, you've missed out a lot already on having that puppy raised in a barn for its first 2 months. And the other part of that is how good the maternal care is. So the mom dog also contributes a lot to the puppy's personality. And that is from, well, it's from before birth. It's from while they're still in the uterus. And it's while they're in the nest, before they're even coming out of the nest and moving around. So before humans have a whole lot to do with them. And then it's as long as mom is living with the puppy. And so that's the other thing that I think a lot of us don't think about asking. But when I got my puppy, as a herding breed, I asked what kind of mom was she? And I was told she's a great mom. She really enjoyed raising her puppies. And that's important. You know, if you hear, oh, you know, she's sort of was kind of clueless, or she didn't really like the puppies much and left them alone a lot, you know, some mom dogs are like that. And that is not a great start for a resilient dog.